Katya, and we will be interpreting into Spanish this evening.
Wait, wrong language. Trabajamos con un concepto que se llama justicia del lenguaje, y la justicia del lenguaje incluye el derecho de todos, de todes, de comunicar, entender, y ser entendidos en el idioma en el que se sienten más cómodos.
So we work in the context of language justice, and language justice means that everyone has the right to engage and to be understood in the language that they feel most comfortable in, that they speak in, that they feel most welcome in.
Parte de este concepto es también que la justicia del lenguaje es responsabilidad de todas en un espacio y no solamente de los intérpretes.
And part of this concept as well is that language justice is the responsibility of everyone and not just of the interpreters.
Y hay algunas formas de las que nos pueden echar una mano, literalmente.
And there are a couple of ways that you can literally lend us a hand.
Primero, pedimos a las personas que van a hablar, que van a presentar, que hablen despacio para darnos chance de interpretar. Y si nos ven con cara de pánico haciendo esto, cualquier persona que nos vea, le pedimos que por favor también lo repitan para que la persona que está hablando lo vea y pueda hablar un poco más despacio.
So we will ask of the folks speaking this evening to speak a little bit slower, that way we can keep up with you. And if you happen to see us with a look of panic on our face doing this, and whoever happens to see us, please do it with us. It just means that we need you to speak a little bit slower to ensure that we can keep up with you in the interpretation.
Si nos ven haciendo esto, quiere decir que por alguna razón no escuchamos. Puede ser que la persona que está hablando tenga que acercar el micrófono un poquito más, que haya ruido, cualquier cosa, pero eso quiere decir que no escuchamos.
And if you happen to see us doing that, and whoever sees us also, please do it with us. It means that we're having a difficult time hearing you. It may be a mic issue. There may be a lot of background noise. You may need to get closer to your mic. So just do a little bit of troubleshooting so that way we can hear you and conclude with our interpretation.
Y finalmente, las personas que nos están escuchando en español se van a dar cuenta que en vez de las terminaciones A y O, usamos la terminación E. No es un error de pronunciación, sino es un esfuerzo muy consciente de romper el binario de género y crear espacios más inclusivos.
And for those that speak Spanish and will be listening to this in Spanish, you will be noticing that we will be using the E form rather than the A or the O. That's not a mistake, it's intentional. It's our effort to create, to block and cut through binary gendered forms.
Y pues eso nada más. Muchísimas gracias por dejarnos apoyar a esta causa súper importante, a esta lucha importante. Y ahora vamos a cambiar a la interpretación simultánea. Entonces, si ocupan interpretación, van a ver un botón en forma de globito en su pantalla, abajo en su pantalla, y ahí pueden escoger el español.
Thank you so much. It's really a pleasure to support this effort, to support your cause and have us be a part of it. And now we're going to be moving into simultaneous interpretation. So what that means is once the feature has been turned on, you will see two bubbles at the bottom of your screen. You will then select your preferred language. It'll be either English or Spanish.
Great. Thank you so much. And as you heard, we have simultaneous Spanish translation for this call. To switch over to the Spanish interpretation, click the button that says interpretation at the bottom of your screen and change it from English to Spanish. If you've dialed in by phone and need interpretation, unfortunately, it's only available if you're logged into the Zoom app and can access the video conference. So if you can install that on your phone or desktop, you should be able to follow the same instructions. For tonight, we also have interpretation in Haitian and Creole. If you wish to join that line, please dial 617-675-4444. The PIN is 957-139-420-2545#. We'll put that in the chat. It's great to be on the phone with you tonight and to talk about our campaign for a homes guarantee. and what we can do together to win what we all deserve. This is part of an ongoing series run by People's Action and the Action Center for Race and the Economy. Many of you have joined us on Homes Guaranteed Thursdays since the pandemic hit. These calls have become places for building relationships, briefings on what's going on across the country, and strategic thinking on what's next. Tonight, we can't move forward without acknowledging the context around us. Black people have been murdered at the hands of the state and are rising up in moments of pain and crisis. We must make meaning. We have to form a collective analysis around this pain and sharpen our imagination and our demands about the world that we need. Tonight, we're here to take a first step towards that. We'll do a training on property, policing, and racial capitalism. Before we get going, I want to tell you a little bit about the logistics of the call. Because of how many people are on the phone, all your lines are muted. If you're joining us on video, you'll be able to see the faces of the speakers. If you have a question and you're joining us through the Zoom app, you can type it into the question and answer box. You'll see that at the bottom of your screen. And we'll respond to as many as we can later in the program. Now feel free to use the chat box to communicate with other participants. If you're not on Zoom and just dialed in through the phone, it's more than okay. We're glad you're all here. And just so you know, we are recording this call to share with people who weren't able to join us tonight. And we do not intend for this to be a media call, but speakers should assume that they are in public and on record. Finally, the call is scheduled to wrap by the end of the hour. And now I want to kick it over to Tiana to share a personal grounding in this moment.
Hello, my name is Tiana Caldwell, and I am a leader with Casey Tennant in Kansas City, Missouri. My whole life is Black men. And I say that word men with quotes because our boys become men as soon as they are no longer considered cute and adorable, but deemed by society a threat. And this happens while others their age are still considered just babies. While police departments across our nation, like the one that took my daddy's life, are overfunded and underregulated, there are people homeless and dying on the streets. While our government continues to bail out big business and moneyed interests, we the people are left with crumbs. Where I live, my city spends $833 on the police for every $1 spent for tenants. And that ain't right. Right now, my money is being spent to fund police forces that are out there protecting racist monuments in a part of our city that's owned by a private out-of-state real estate trust. While the people are being tear gassed, dragged through the streets, and that ain't right. My family's lives are worth more than private property. This is the perfect time for a homes guarantee. We know that all of these injustices are connected. They stem from decades of racist policy and neglect. It stems from a system so corrupt and deeply rooted in racism that we find ourselves in this place. A place we could have avoided had we just taken care of each other. Now, more than ever, we need justice. And it starts by defunding the racist systems around us and investing in our lives, our futures, our babies, our homes. And it could start right now with a homes guarantee. Thank you.
Thank you so much for sharing, Tiana. I really appreciate that and your groundedness in this moment. And thank you for holding space on this call, John. My name is Tara Rockevere, and I'm an organizer with the Campaign for a National Homes Guarantee at People's Action. And I'm gonna kick us off with this training that we have tonight. So I want you, if you're able, to grab a piece of paper and a pen. It's okay if you're not close to any one of them, but we are gonna be doing a little bit of interaction off of just the digital format tonight. I also wanna ground us before we begin this training by saying that when we do trainings with our base of people who are directly impacted by these problems and the structures and systems around us, we are not doing a training because we feel we have anything to teach. We're rather trusting that the people closest to the problem are the closest to the solutions, and that actually people's direct experience with these systems and these structures is the expertise that we need to inform our work. So I wanted to say that, and instead of presenting lessons, we're actually intending to present a set of ideas, concepts, and agitations that can lead to some reflection among this group tonight that can hopefully help sharpen our collective work together. So with that being said, I'm going to share my screen for a couple of slides that can help us get rooted in this moment. Give me 1 second to do that. John, can you give me a thumbs up when you can see my screen? Great. Okay, so the first concept that we want to offer is a concept that informs a lot of our work with the Homes Guarantee, and it's something called racial capitalism. But before we get there, I want to direct your attention to the right side of the screen. If you're viewing this on your Zoom app, there are all of these circles. The circles with the R, that stands for racism. The circles with the C, that stands for capitalism. And let's just go through each of these layers. So the first level of the diagram here with the R and the C in separate circles, that's meant to represent some folks who view the world and understand that racism and capitalism exist, but they exist as separate systems and they fundamentally are separated from one another. There's another understanding of the world wherein racism is the dominant system and capitalism flows from racism or is a less relevant system in the United States or otherwise than racism. The opposite is also true, right? All of us know people who are kind of class reductionists and believe that capitalism is a dominant system and racism is a product of that system or is something that only lives within the system of capitalism. And then finally, this last diagram, bottom of the slide on the right, has the R and C circles separate but slightly intersecting, which is to say there are some folks who understand the world where racism and capitalism are basically separate systems but have some intersection. What we want to introduce is the idea of racial capitalism, which is that in the United States, based on the history of this country, there is a system of racial capitalism wherein wealth, profit, and power are gained among the ruling class from the exploitation and the oppression of working class and poor people of all colors, and that ruling class is disproportionately white, right? So that this is actually not a place where these exist as separate systems or where one system is dominant over the other, but rather the system of racial capitalism is one in which we can understand the American economic system and everything about how our society works. This definition is drawn in part from the works of Cedric Robinson in Black Marxism and other writings. The next two concepts that I want to introduce, and these definitions are provided by our comrades at the Action Center on Race and the Economy, are financialization and policing. And financialization is a big word. It's complicated. I didn't really know what it meant until I stared at this definition. But actually, all of us really know what this means because we live it every day. Basically, financialization is a more recent stage of racial capitalism that's characterized by introducing the financial sector or privatization into every aspect of our lives. So corporations and finance and private ownership determine things like our basic services and our basic industries that we all rely on, from everything from housing to education to healthcare and even water. And then the definition of policing that we want to work with tonight is that policing is not limited to just the police, like the cops that we see on the street, but rather a whole system that includes surveillance and private security, and also includes things like the immigration and customs enforcement and ways in which systemically we target folks of various immigration statuses as well. And policing as a system is set up to target Black and Brown communities, communities of color, poor communities, and LGBTQ communities. And often, police and other forms of policing are used as tools to protect private wealth and property. Okay, I'm not tracking the chat, so if something's going down in the chat, one of the panelists will have to let me know. But those are kind of concepts that we want to put out there. Financialization, policing, and obviously within financialization is this really interesting nugget, which we're going to dig into today, which is property, right? Private property and how that plays into all of this. So the thing that I want you to do with your piece of paper, if you have one with you right now, is draw two circles. And in one of the circles, put police or policing. And in the other circle, put private property. And I want you to just take a moment to connect these circles somehow. You can draw, you can write, do whatever you want that can help you articulate or envision your understanding of how these two things are related, how private property and policing or the police are related. And then dig a level deeper, and I want you to reflect on this personally. How has policing and how has private property, how have these two things been connected in your own life? And I'll give you about 90 seconds to do some of this connecting. And then I want you all, if you're comfortable, to share out in the chat what these connections look like for you theoretically and also in your personal life. You have about a minute, and I invite anyone who has a reflection on how policing and property are connected, especially in your personal life, to put that in the chat if you feel comfortable. Okay, Annie's in the chat with an interesting, perhaps obvious, but really important reflection. Police enforce evictions, right? Our public money is spent on a police force that oftentimes are the enforcers of the evictions of our people out of privately owned properties. That's an interesting nugget that we gotta dig into. Jess shares that they're from a wealthy white neighborhood and police get paid a lot of money to make sure that rich white folks are kept safe. And the irony is that those kinds of neighborhoods maybe don't need that kind of protection of their private property. That's interesting, Jess, thank you. If you don't pay, you're under arrest. This is huge, right? The whole idea that policing, and John will get into this more, there are fees and fines associated with some petty or civil crimes that then can lead to arrest. And sometimes those have to do with property. Okay, keep the reflections coming. I think one of the core lessons that we want to draw out here is this lesson that often in the way that we know policing in America, policing is used as a tool to protect private property. And in fact, as John will tell you in a second, the history of policing is embedded in that as one of the core motivations for why policing exists in America in the way that it does. So I'm going to hand it over to John at this point to give us a brief history of policing in the United States.
Great. Thank you so much. And it looks like a lot of folks in the chat are already making some of these connections. Before I really dig into this, I do want to name that we are often told a very different history of what has happened in the United States and how the different systems in our country have developed than is actually true. And we really want to dismantle and clarify some of those narratives and connect them to folks' lived experience. So the police actually started off as slave catchers. I'm a hip hop head. So for those of you who heard Sound of the Police by KRS-One, it talks about the word officer and the word overseer. And so what started to happen was that as slave rebellions became larger and more coordinated, different municipalities organized police forces and rewards for catching slaves. And they would offer money or land for folks who were able to catch and return slaves. And there's actually a famous Dred Scott case about the right that property owners have to hold power over bodies across the Mason-Dixon line. And in fact, you know, how runaway slaves could be returned if caught, despite the fact that slavery was illegal in certain states. From being slave catchers, we move on to the Black Codes. And so Reconstruction is a very important part of our history because it really redefined this evolution of what we're now referring to as neoliberalism, but this way in which the slaves were freed, but not really. And so while everyone was free, the Black Codes were a set of laws that made it virtually illegal for any Black person to exist in space without a note from a white person or a relationship or the ability to prove that they were doing the work of the white world. And what this did is it allowed for the creation of our mass incarceration and prison system. They basically said, you can be free, but if you're not working for us, through a private mechanism, then we are going to arrest you. We're going to put you in prison and use Black bodies as prison laborers. And that was the beginning of our prison system. During the Industrial Revolution and prior to the Industrial Revolution, police forces, both private and municipal police forces, were used for union busting. And so police have always had a social position of controlling labor. Obviously, that has shown up different for white unions as it did for former slaves and slaves during the slave catching and Reconstruction era. So they were used to break strikes, to murder workers who were refusing to work in order to get greater conditions. As this evolution continues into the era of, you know, between World War I and World War II, we see lots of new white immigrants moving in and often being treated not as people of color, but also as non-white. And so part of the system of racial bribery that allows for many of the European ethnicities that were considered minorities when they first got to this country was actually offering them the position of policing other communities. And so there's the narratives about the Irish and the paddy wagon. And anybody who's watched Gangs of New York and these other movies sees the race dynamics among white folks that existed during this period. And one way that they allowed for folks to have skin privilege was to offer the right and encourage the policing of one community over another as a way of creating that racial bribery and dominance that allowed for a lot of those white folks to assimilate. While that was happening, obviously we had Jim Crow. And so along with Jim Crow, if you look at the red lines that were drawn around communities, many of which look very similar today, you will also see lines around how neighborhoods and space was policed. And so there were many folks during the two great migrations during this period who moved from the South to the North for industrial jobs as industrial growth made capital really need Black bodies to do industrial labor. As that was happening, many folks were trying to move into all white communities and the police supported white folks defending their communities from people of color, especially Black people, moving into neighborhoods and reinforced many of those those red lines that had to do with the financialization and growth of our housing market. And this is really what solidified, you know, many of the ghettos of America. During the civil rights era, we see, you know, the growing response to lynching you know, complete impunity for white folks. And we're all familiar with Ida B. Wells and many of the folks who ran this anti-lynching movement that led right up to the civil rights movement and really motivated a lot of folks to take a stand against this racial injustice. But police were able to operate with impunity and they were, you know, brutalizing and murdering people of color. And much of the civil rights movement was really motivated by this idea that if there was representation through voting, that would affect how policing worked, how juries worked, and how the cases that many people saw as so unfair were working. As we move into from the civil rights movement into the Black Power movement into more of the modern time, we see a very clear strategy that recently many folks in the Johnson administration and Lyndon B. Johnson's administration left, that they created a war on drugs to demonize people of color and to create a pretext to over-police neighborhoods of color. And so the war on drugs was really a war on poor Black and brown folks, and that really created what we call the new Jim Crow since, you know, Michelle Alexander's amazing book came out. But before that book really captured the relationship between the old Jim Crow and the new Jim Crow, you know, folks really saw that the war on drugs led to the current model of policing we have, which is policing for profit. It means that police are really a way for cities to make money off of fines, fees, bail, and to create prisons around the country that are in rural neighborhoods that are really the rural economy and creating housing markets for people who have jobs in those areas. So the brief history of American policing shows that there is an intrinsic relationship between how policing works and how neighborhoods and communities are policed and the access to property and good living conditions that folks have.
Thank you so much, John. And John, did you have any questions that you wanted to have people reflect out in the chat?
Yes. So I did want to have people reflect on what people say about your community and how true it is. And every community has a narrative that drives the prices, the valuation, and the financialization of your community, and also how it's policed. So I know that I live on the west side of Buffalo, and everybody says it's full of a bunch of crazy Puerto Ricans, and that is what is used to scare white folks into staying away from this neighborhood. But I'm really interested in what other folks hear about their neighborhoods, how they're described, and how that relates to the value of property and how they're policed.
So as you're reflecting that out in the chat, do continue to reflect on narratives that people use about your community, good, bad, or ugly. Put those in the chat so we can all kind of see that together. And in the meantime, I'm going to introduce a special guest that we have on the call tonight. It's my pleasure to introduce Phil McHarris, a joint PhD candidate in sociology and African American studies at Yale. His research focuses on race, punishment, and policing, drawing on qualitative and quantitative methods. And his dissertation actually explores the strategies that residents of a high-rise housing project in Brooklyn, New York, employ to foster safety and disrupt police violence. Philip recently wrote a piece for the New York Times on the urgent need to defund the police. I'm gonna drop that in the chat. Probably a lot of you already saw it. But I've been learning a lot from Philip and his work, the work of some of his comrades. So basically, John and I are gonna do a Q&A with Philip. And then for the rest of you, if you have questions for Phil or for anyone else on this call, just drop them in the chat or the Q&A box, and we'll be paying attention to those spaces. And as time allows, we will call out those questions. So John, take it away.
Yeah, first, we know that you're probably holding a lot right now, as we all are. So wanted to know how you're doing, and if you have any personal reflections on this moment with the uprisings and what's coming next.
Yeah, you know, it feels real good to be joined with y'all. You know, this is really dope. So thank you for having me. And I mean that sincerely. I mean, yeah, it's definitely been a lot, you know, to hold. I think a lot about policing and police violence in general. And so these moments of, you know, where it's sort of a heightened moment of sort of police violence and protests around it, you know, it leaves me both drained and also hopeful. You know, I'm really excited about this moment. I think what we're seeing now is a rebellion that cuts across race, you know, across the country, and is really moving things forward. So that's leaving me to feel hopeful. And also defunding the police is being talked about, you know, more than ever right now. And so that's also leaving me hopeful. And, you know, different municipalities and city and state officials are talking about defunding the police when, you know, years ago, most people heard it and it seemed absurd. It was just sort of, you know, it seemed ridiculous. And so, yeah, I'm feeling, you know, a little bit exhausted, but also very hopeful. And, you know, I think this moment is, it's never been a moment, at least in my lifetime, where I've seen a greater capacity for radical demands and radical policy in action.
Thanks so much for joining us, Phil. As I said, we've been deeply grateful for your work and for the leadership of groups like the Movement for Black Lives and so many scholars, academics, writers, organizers who have created the potential for us to imagine a future that looks radically different and a future where we disrupt the relationship between policing and property that we've been discussing today. So what analysis can you add, having heard a little bit of our grounding about that relationship between policing and property, and how do we dismantle it? What's your playbook about what comes next?
So, I mean, I do want to start by lifting up Breonna Taylor. And, you know, John mentioned the war on drugs. And during the war on drugs, it paved the way for a number of policy shifts. One of the main was sort of this creation of no-knock warrants and quick-knock warrants. You know, and that paves the way for a police force during a botched raid to go into, you know, Breonna Taylor's home as she slept with her partner and murder her with no, you know, accountability. And so, you know, when I think about that, it's, you know, in your house, in your home, you're supposed to be safe, but police and police violence and sort of these sorts of kinds of policing remind us that even in, you know, our own homes, when we sleep, it's not necessarily safe for us, right? And that the other part is that, you know, Breonna's partner had a gun and was shooting back at the police, and they charged him for attempted murder on an officer when, you know, they were in his house and he thought it was just somebody, you know, there to do him harm. And so I think it's, you know, important to think about that aspect of that. It's not only the neighborhoods, but it's also how police can come into people's homes. And I've experienced that where police have come into my home and I've been looking at them like, what are you doing? And, you know, they're looking at, I remember the last time it happened because of a fire alarm went off and the police showed up, came into my house, and I was sitting there and he was looking at me like, why are you nervous? And I'm like, why are you here? And so, you know, I think, you know, just thinking through that is, you know, important. More broadly, I've been thinking a lot about the New Deal and the way in which it came after the, you know, the Great Depression, right? And so now, because of the coronavirus, it's the largest recession that we've seen since then. And, you know, Johnson is touted as this person who created, you know, this movement for housing. He created these federal pathways for housing. And, you know, the thing is that everything was good except it was racist, right? And so it actually facilitated the creation of resource-rich suburbs over time and resource-deprived ghettos. And that along those lines, police begin to emerge to police the problem areas, as you mentioned, and, you know, to protect the resource havens. And so I think coming out of this moment, it's the rebellion, and it's also COVID, which creates this moment where, you know, it's showing, it's sort of showcasing the need for just housing. And, you know, we don't have it right now, which is why there's so many houseless folks, which is why people are worried about being evicted once the pandemic ends. And so I think, you know, this moment is, it's an interesting one in the sense of the last time we actually had a real commitment to housing, though it was racist, was out of the Great Depression. And now we're in another moment where the crisis of housing has never been more apparent. And so, you know, relatedly, public housing also begun, really starts to emerge after Johnson and the New Deal. And, you know, over time, it just became, once it became clear that it was for Black folks, it was for, you know, marginalized communities of color, immigrants, what happened was there's been decades long divestment in public housing. And the work that I do is actually in a housing project in Brooklyn. And what I see is that there's just, the neglect is abundant. And, you know, police patrol the area. Now they're either literally in front of the building or they're inside the lobby and they don't do anything. They're just there, you know, and in some ways they serve as an indicator to the surrounding area, to gentrifiers at the neighborhood, that it's safe because they're there, you know, and it's supposed to communicate some sense of security. But for folks who feel triggered and uncomfortable by police presence, it serves as a constant trigger and reminder, especially because they're essentially the gatekeepers, that once you enter your home, you're going to see police. Once you leave your home, you're going to see police. And even when you're inside your residence, you're gonna see police lights because they're constantly on. And you know, this comes at the same time when the gas in the housing project that I study has been shut off since the beginning of the pandemic. So no one is able to cook and they've been given hot plates. And this has been going on for weeks. And NYCHA says it's a result of capital divestment. But you know, this sort of segues into the piece around defunding is that police get in the United States $100 billion every year across the country. And that's billions of dollars that could be going to creating housing that's safe and that's comfortable and that's quality and that's also beautiful, right? I think, you know, people deserve to live in places where they feel, you know, dignified and safe. And, you know, it requires a shift and a focus that, you know, everybody, especially, you know, we live in the richest nation in the world, can live in safe and beautiful and comfortable, you know, housing, and that there's an abundant amount of resources from an institution that does harm that can be taken and redirected into housing as well as schools, healthcare, employment that's, you know, with dignity. And yeah, and so I think, you know, and it's not only also, it's policing at the you know, the funding at the city level, but also the state and federal level. There's wide ranges of grants and budgeting decisions that can be drawn from in order to invest in housing, which actually will do more for people feeling safe than police ever will.
Yeah, I just wanted to build a little bit off of what you said, and I appreciate you bringing up the New Deal, because I think most folks don't recognize that our housing market is not that old, and that really the financialization that came by giving basically no interest loans to folks coming out of World War II, white folks, is really what created the suburbs and our housing market. But housing was fundamentally different before that era. And so I think it's an important time to talk about how they were able to financialize and attach long-term wealth with home ownership while denying that access, and usually denying that access. One of the ways was through your record and through where you lived, and through the redlining and those things. And there's also like a parallel track of you look at the divestment from housing and the investment in prison, they perfectly mirror each other. Once they stopped building more housing, they started building more prisons. And so I just want to follow up with this question of, you know, with this analysis and these ways that we can divest and what we can invest, I want to hear some about your imagination. What do you think we could do with housing if we were divesting from police?
Oh, I mean, the opportunities are limitless and endless. I think that, you know, we can have affordable housing, and I think it's important. I think in, you know, the platform that you all have put forth, what's critical is that I think you focus on providing different options for people where they are. And so a model that emerged, and sort of it's similar to what you were mentioning with your question earlier, John, is, you know, what are the narratives around certain places and where in certain neighborhoods? And public housing projects began, you know, this certain narrative of it's dangerous, it's crime ridden, it's drug infested, these sorts of, you know, often, you know, racist and classist language in order to describe certain places. And the result was, you know what, all right, you know, what we did here with this public housing stuff, it failed. And so we need to just start knocking all of them down. The ones that are the worst, we need to just knock them down, which we see in Chicago, St. Louis, and, you know, across the country in different places, which then led to this financialization of this sort of private market economy, you know, Section 8 vouchers, which is incredibly hard to get on, and the wait is very extensive. And so, you know, as opposed to taking a step back and saying, okay, you know, if we invest $5 billion into this specific public housing residence, right, or these sets of public housing residences, what could we do, right? And as the demand on the bill talks about, you know, it's clearing backlogs. It's easy to clear backlog repairs. But in addition to that, you can renovate the entire buildings. You can renovate entire structures to be comfortable, quality. And, you know, one of the things that I think is even important to think about is that in the and oftentimes in different housing projects, right, there's police patrol all the time, right? What would it look like to have a custodial or maintenance worker that if something breaks was there pretty much at all times to help, right? That would serve as a much more of a function than having a like police officers that sit there and just don't do anything, right? And so, you know, I think that if we divested from punishment, whether it's police, prisons, and also I think thinking about defense spending, you know, the amount of money that the United States spends on defense is ridiculous. And that's another target, I think, of divest efforts. But, you know, I think that we can create and structure a world in which does not put profit, in which people, you know, attempts to find housing does not come down to whether or not they can afford to live in a nice and quality place, but that it's just a guarantee. You know, that and it is true to certain degrees in other countries as well. And I think, you know, it's incredibly important to just think about, you know, just like it's hundreds of billions of dollars that can be drawn on and that can really create safe housing. And there was a statistic that was floating around that a vast majority of the people that end up in prison were housing insecure before their incarceration. And, you know, and when we think about folks that are queer, that are trans, that are gender nonconforming, that end up sort of leaving their homes because they don't feel safe and end up engaging in survival economies that render them more vulnerable to arrest, right, and incarceration. And so, you know, one of these things that we think about, like, what does it look like to create a safe community, a safe neighborhood? And I think if everyone had a guarantee to safe and quality and nice and beautiful housing, that it will fundamentally change a community in and of itself, you know? And I think just even thinking about, you know, the lessons of the past, when we think about the rebellions that went across the nation after King was assassinated, what was passed was the Fair Housing Act, right? That was one of the main things that come out. You know, Johnson quickly went and, you know, passed the Fair Housing Act. And so, you know, I think that it's another moment where we think about sort of comparisons today where we see rebellions across the country. I think centering housing as a sort of a reinvestment, not only in alternative emergency response models, but also community infrastructure. Housing is key in order to creating and maintaining safe communities.
Ooh, beautiful. We love to hear that, Phil. You said guarantee like three times and the Homes Guarantee crew is on fire. I love it. So we have a really good question from Bo in the chat. And Bo asks, since lots of us are housing organizers, how can tenant unions advance community safety and transformative justice practices? Abolitionist, we keep us safe practices often rely on place-based relationships, which building and neighborhood-based tenant unions can help create. Do you see potential for tenant unions to incorporate community safety and transformative justice into their work? And it sounds like this is really actually related to the project that you study.
Yeah, for sure. You know, I think, yeah, in order to push for all of this, I think, you know, it requires a base and it requires a refusal to be co-opted by, you know, police and the criminal justice system more broadly. And I think in terms of, you know, when I think of tenant unions, you know, I think it's definitely one in a major apparatus, I think, can start to push and mobilize people in order to conceive of what does it look like to have a blueprint for what safety can look like in our community, amongst our residents. You know, what can it look like? What are the possibilities? And how do we go about mobilizing power in order to shift, you know, focus away from policing and their relationship to financialization and property and gentrification? And what does it look like to design our own community-based models of what it would look like to keep this community safe? And I think one of the main things, it's maybe not necessarily true with in terms of tenant unions, but in terms of tenant associations, a lot of times what police do, at least what I've seen in New York, is that, you know, the community policing folks will begin to develop relationships, you know, and basically it's sort of, it becomes like PR, right? It's like, well, we work with this community and we know the tenant association leader and, you know, we're doing good in this community. And so there's a bit of, you know, manipulation that sometimes happens, in part because folks are also trying to figure out, you know, how to. So, yeah, because folks are trying to figure out how, you know, that they can go about managing concerns of safety and how they can better their community. And, you know, I think one of the important things, and it's something that I've been thinking a lot about recently, is that folks, you know, for example, that live in, you know, communities that are resource deprived places, oftentimes police become the only sort of state intervention, or they become the only government service that is sort of well-funded and that will come to the neighborhood, right? So it's like, sometimes people end up in a situation where it's like, well, we really want the elevators fixed and we really want, you know, our block to look better, and we really want some trees planted, and we want safe housing, and we don't necessarily want, you know, police to come. So it becomes this thing, but really oftentimes the government says, well, we'll give you police. Do you want some police that stay outside your house, you know, or just patrol the neighborhood? And, you know, so I think it's definitely important to sort of just sit with all of it. And, you know, I the piece also that was mentioned around sheriffs and police evicting people, you know, it's in terms of the financialization piece, it's also I think important that, you know, to see, especially in your county where you live. For example, where I live, the sheriff department actually manages and sells foreclosed homes. So they come and evict you, and then they're responsible for the week. They literally meet every Tuesday, and you come and you can put in a bid to buy a foreclosed home that was evicted, you know? And so I think the ways in which all of these things, you know, correlate again, it's definitely all connected.
Thanks so much, Phil. John, any reactions or closing words for us before we head out?
Yeah, I just really wanted to thank you and just so aligned with, you know, what you've said and the work that you do. And I want to urge all of us to continue to try in this moment to connect these relationships, because part of how capitalism works is it is a very intersectional format, and we really need to be intersectional as well if we do want to create the vision that Phil talked about for our communities. Also wanted to do just a real quick evaluation of this call. So if everyone who's able to, and I'm sorry for the folks who are not, could put a feeling word in the chat about how you're feeling after this conversation. We really do want to get feedback. We also have the homes@peoplesaction.org. Hopefully someone can drop that in the chat for me so folks can reach out and just give us some feedback on how this went. Obviously, I could have this conversation for hours. And really just want to kind of close with just some clarity that police are the foreclosures, they're the evictors, and they're overseers of our community. It's impossible not to react to what we've seen over the past few months, but we cannot also forget that while, you know, the death of George Floyd and others have sparked this moment, we live in communities where people are experiencing violence from police on a daily basis. And we cannot allow this movement to just be about the murders, but more about the relationship that police have to our economy and to us as people and to the values that we want to be put forward in the world through our elected officials. And we do that by doing calls like this, by developing our understanding and developing the understandings in the communities so that we can work to on a national scale to divest from police and invest in housing systems that we know in the past, as Phil alluded to, have been successful at creating stable communities. Loving some of the words that I'm seeing in the chat, especially, you know, co-conspire. So really appreciate all the love and the participation that folks have shown on this call. And we're really excited to continue these Homes Guaranteed Thursdays, especially with the folks like Bo, who've been with us pretty much every week. I mean, that's really all we have for tonight. We look forward to working through some of the questions, some of the tensions, and wanted to just shout out Phil if he had any closing words for us.
You know, I think, this has been a really dope experience. I appreciate you opening up the space to me. And I think, you know, what this moment is teaching has taught many people is that, you know, what people power, and something that I think a lot of people have known, but we're seeing it, is that when people gather and collectively decide that enough is enough, worlds are born.
It's a powerful way to close out. Thank you all for joining us, and we'll see you next Thursday.
Panelists, stick around for a minute. We'll let folks leave. John, what was the song that you were talking about, the KRS-One song?
It's called Sound of the Police.
I've got some exit music for folks.
That's the sound of the police. Whoop, whoop. That's the sound of the beast. Whoop, whoop. That's the sound of the police. Whoop, whoop. That's the sound of the beast. Whoop, whoop. That's the sound of the police. Whoop, whoop. That's the sound of the beast. Whoop, whoop. That's the sound of the police. Whoop, whoop. That's the sound of the beast. That's the sound of the police. Whoop, whoop. That's the sound.
example, overseer. Yeah, officer from overseer. You need a little clarity, check the similarity. The overseer rode around the plantation. The officer is on patrol in our nation. The overseer could stop you what you're doing. The officer will pull you over just when he's pursuing. The overseer had the right to get ill. And if you fought back, the overseer had the right to kill. The officer has the right to arrest. And if you fight back, they put a hole in your chest. They both ride horses. After 400 years, I got no choices. The police don't have a nickel gun. So when I'm on the streets, I walk around with a bigger one. I hear it all day. Just so they can run the light and be upon their way.
Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed.
That's the sound of the police. That's the sound of the bees. That's the sound of the police. That's the sound of the bees. Check out the message in a rough style. The real criminal, I'll see or be. You check for undercover anyone, DG. But just got me a black man, they won't check me. They check out me, y'all, courage shine like the sun. But them jealous of them next guy, they can't afford one. Black people still slaves up to today. But the black police officer, let's see it that way. He wants him salary, he wants it. So he put on a badge and kill people for aid. My grandfather had to deal with the cops. My great-grandfather dealt with the cops. My great-grandfather had to deal with the cops. And then my great-great-great-great, when it's gonna stop? That's the sound of the police. That's the sound of the bees. That's the sound of the police. That's the sound of the bees. That's the sound of the police. That's the sound of the bees. That's the sound of the police. That's the sound of the bees.
Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed.
That's the sound of the police. That's the sound of the bees. That's the sound of the police. That's the sound of the bees.